Hello students, today I'm going to teach you the story The Great Stone Face by the very famous American novelist, dark romantic, Nathaniel Hawthorne. Okay, so without further ado, let us start the story The Great Stone Face. Open your book, open your main textbook. So a little bit about Nathaniel Hawthorne. He was an American novelist. All of you have, if you are an avid reader, you would know that his famous work is The Scarlet Letter. Okay, you will be reading this when you grow up a little bit. If you read this novel, you will understand the style with which Nathaniel Hawthorne used to write. Okay, he is also a very famous short story writer. The story that has been included in our text, The Great Stone Face, it has been divided into two parts, maybe because it is too lengthy. It is a short story. Okay, and his works, they normally focus on morality, religion, society, okay, faith, then history of a place, culture of a place. Based on that, it revolves around that. Okay, so about a little bit about The Great Stone Face. It is a short story. It's like a fanciful short story, you may say. It is about the life of a New England resident who learns wisdom by gazing upon the stone rock formation, mountain rock formation, which looks like a face. Okay, so the great stone face is actually a resemblance of a face on a mountain. It has not been artificially carved, but it exists in that manner. Okay, it is not artificially carved, it is a work of nature. It's like a miracle of nature, and because of some reason, you all have learned about the effects of weathering of rock, right? So because of different agents, the rock or the mountain in that which is facing their valley, facing the valley in which the story takes place, looks like the face of a old man. Now, not only this, there's also a prophecy which revolves around it, and the prophecy is that one day a man will come into the valley who will have the exact resemblance to that great stone face, and that man will be a very noble and very great man, and he will bring about a great change in the society. So this story revolves around the great stone face and a child's fascination with it. This child's name is Ernest. And Ernest, whenever, ever since he heard about the prophecy, he has this fancy that he will be able to live to see that man who bears the resemblance with the great stone face. Okay, now he grows up into a young man and he just goes on trying to find the likeness with that face. Okay, so let us begin the story, The Great Stone Face. The first part. Okay, this is chapter number 9. Seen from a distance, hilltops and huge rocks seem to assume various shapes. They may resemble an animal or a human figure. People attribute stories to these shapes. Some stories come true, some doesn't. The great stone face is one such shape that reminds the inhabitants of the valley of a prophecy. Okay, so look at the picture which has been drawn. It is just to give you a little bit of idea about what it might be like. Okay, so the residents in the valley, they can see the great stone face from a distance. One afternoon, let us begin the text. One afternoon, when the sun was going down, a mother and her little boy sat at the door of their cottage talking about the great stone face. They had only to lift their eyes and there it was, plain to be seen, though miles away, with the sunshine brightening all its features. So one afternoon when it was a time for sunset, a mother and her little boy, they were sitting at their cottage and they were talking about the great stone face, which they could very nicely see at this time. It was plain to be seen. That means it can be directly seen, it can be properly seen, though it was miles away from where they were sitting, and the sunshine was brightening its features. It was making it even easier for them to look at the stone face. And what was the great stone face? The Great Stone Face was a work of nature formed on the perpendicular side of a mountain. You know what a perpendicular side is, right? You know about right angles and perpendiculars, right? So it means the straight side. Maybe the mountain had a kind of straight one side. Okay, so towards the rock rising very okay, the meaning has been given, cliff or rock face rising very steeply, almost like a perpendicular angle, okay, or almost like a 90 degree angle. So this great stone face, it was a work of nature. Nobody had made it. It was not an artificially carved rock, but it was a work of nature formed on the perpendicular side of a mountain by some immense rocks which had been thrown together so that when viewed at a proper distance they resemble the features of a human face. So this was not just one rock which had this carving, but number of rocks, they were like jammed together, as sometimes happen in cases of low hill areas, and they looked certain way, and if you look at it clearly it might seem to be like a human face. Okay, maybe not as clear as the picture which has been given in your book. It has just been given for reference, but somewhat of a resemblance you can understand. If the spectator approached too near, he lost the outline of the enormous face and could see only a heap of gigantic rocks. If the spectator approached too near, that means if a person who is looking at the face, if they want to come too near to the, you know, the mountain, they will not understand that it looks like a face. Unless you see it from a distance, nobody can understand it. Okay, nobody can get the resemblance that it had with a stone face. And if a person went too near the gigantic rock, they will only see that a heap of big gigantic rocks are piled on one on top of other with no resemblance of a face. Okay, so if you see it from a distance, you can understand that yes, it looks like a face, but if you come very near, you will just see rocks are there piled upon each other. But seen from a distance, the clouds clustering about it, clustering means coming together, gathering around it, the great stone face seemed positively to be alive. It was the belief of many people that the valley owed much of its fertility to the benign face that was continually beaming over it. Now this is also very nice, that the face of the great stone face is not a malicious face. It's a benign face. It's a face which has full of kindness, which is full of kindness, which looks as if it's smiling on the residents of the valley, and that's a great thing, because the residents held a belief that whatever this face represented, or whoever it was, this face, this more than human shape, this was the reason why their valley was so fertile. Okay, this was a mark of its happiness. A mother and her little boy, as we said earlier, sat at the door of their cottage, gazing at the great stone face and talking about it. The child's name was Ernest. "Mother," said he, while the great stone face smiled on him. Okay, it seemed whenever that little boy looked at the face, it seemed that the person, that the face is smiling at him. Okay, and that's why the child is fascinated with it. "I wish that it could speak, for it looks so very kindly that its voice must indeed be pleasant. If I ever see a man with such a face, I should love him very much." So this boy, he feels very, he smiles, and the fact that the great stone face looked at him in that smiling manner, and it seemed almost to be alive. Okay. So that's why the little boy thought that I just wish that it could smile, it could talk like a human, and it can communicate with me, because a face which looks so kindly must have a beautiful voice as well. "If an old prophecy should come to pass," answered his mother, "we may see a man sometime with exactly such a face as that." Now this prophecy is like a prediction of a future, something that will happen in the future is called a prophecy. For something great is going to happen, a man with who will have the same likeness like this great stone face will come to our valley, and he will be a great and noble man. So this is what his mother tells him, that if you live to see that prophecy, you might actually see a man who resembles the smile of the great stone face, because there's an old prophecy which goes like, there's a person who will come who will look exactly as the great stone face. What prophecy do you mean, dear mother? Eagerly inquired Ernest. Please tell me about it. So his mother told him a story that her own mother had told her when she herself was younger than little Ernest, that at some future day a child should be born near here who was destined to become the greatest and noblest of his time, and whose face in manhood should bear an exact resemblance to the great stone face. So this is the prophecy. Okay, so what is the prophecy? The prophecy is that a child will be born, okay, in the future, in some future day, a child would be born near here who was destined to become the greatest and noblest person of his time, and whose face in manhood should bear an exact resemblance to the great stone face that you can see. Many still had faith in this old prophecy, but others took it to be nothing but idle talk. At all events, the great man of the prophecy had not yet appeared. Okay, so some people remembered this prophecy, some people just thought that it's just like an idle talk, just something that we talk about to pass our time. Nothing, there isn't any truth of it, because if this prophecy was to come true, then this must have happened already, right? A lot of years have passed and nobody who bears the likeness of that man, who had the likeness or resemblance of that great stone face, had yet come. Okay, so nobody actually looked nobody actually gave a lot of thought towards the prophecy. Oh mother, cried Ernest, clapping his hands above his head, I do hope that I shall live to see him. So Ernest claps his hand and says like this, okay, oh mother, I hope I shall live to see that man, that is, I hope that I get the chance to see this great man, okay, about whom everybody talks about. His mother was an affectionate and thoughtful woman. It was proper, she thought, not to discourage the fanciful hopes of a little boy. So she said to him, perhaps you may. Though she was grown up and she knew that there was very little chance of something like that happening. Okay, and maybe in her mind also she thought that this was just a lore. It was just something which people gave a story to for kids. Okay, like it just had become a story for kids, nothing else. And there cannot be any person like that. But because she did not want to discourage him, like all of us more or less knows that there is no Santa Claus, but when we tell, especially in the Christian community, when we tell stories to children, there is sure, there is a, that means of Christian holiday, especially the Christian people, whenever they tell their story of Christmas to the little kids, they are sure to include Santa Claus, right? Likewise, this mother also doesn't want to discourage Ernest, and so she wants to tell him, she wants to give him faith that yes, maybe you will be able to see that great stone face in a person. And Ernest never forgot the story that his mother told him. It was always in his mind whenever he looked upon the great stone face. He spent his childhood in the log cottage where he was born, was dutiful to his mother and helpful to her in many things, assisting her with much with his little hands and more with his loving heart. In this manner, from a happy yet often pensive child, pensive means you will see even among yourself, there are always some of your peers who will have a different kind of outlook towards life. They will maybe sit in the classroom quietly and think about something. Okay, pensive means a person who is constantly thoughtful, who gets constantly lost in daydreamings, thinking about the future, thinking about stuff. Okay, It doesn't mean that they are low performers or underachievers. It is not the case. In fact, they have a different kind of ability. Okay, so pensiveness is also, it exists in adults also. Some people, they talk less, they think more. So he was also a pensive child who was quite thoughtful. Okay, he used to think a lot about things. So quiet and thoughtful. He grew up to be a mild and quiet youth, mild, of a mild nature, not a wild or aggressive, but a timid and tender kind of nature, mild nature, gentle nature. Ernest had no teacher, but the great stone face became one to him. When the work of the day was over, he would gaze at it for hours. So even when he became a young man, the effect of the great stone face could still be felt in him. He still thought about the great stone face, and it was almost like a teacher to him. Even though he didn't have any personal teacher for himself, the great stone face became like a teacher to him. So when the work of the day was over, he would gaze at it for hours until he began to imagine that those vast features recognized him and gave him a smile of kindness and encouragement. So it as if the great stone face was something which recognized the simple life, the simple labor that Ernest had put up throughout the day, and he also appreciated Ernest's work. Okay, and he also gave him a smile of kindness and encouragement not to give up on life. So it was like a mentor to him. Okay, if it was like encouraging him to do better in life. About this time, there went a rumor throughout the valley that the great man who was to bear the resemblance of the great stone face had appeared at last. It seems that many years before, a young man had left the valley and settled at a distant seaport. Gathergold, which was his name, had set up as a shopkeeper, and being sharp in business matters, had become so very rich that it would have taken him 100 years to count his wealth. In time, he thought of his native valley and decided to go back there and end his days where he had been born. So there comes a character of a man whom people started talking about. Suddenly, there was a rumor in the valley that the man who bared the resemblance of the great stone face had at last arrived. And who was that man? This was a very, very successful businessman, Gathergold, and he has become so rich. He has become so rich that his riches were uncountable almost. Okay. Now, Ernest, he was born in this valley, but he had gone outside to work. And after gathering a lot of wealth, he thought about his native place and he thought of returning here. Now, this rumor came. Ernest had been deeply stirred by the idea that the great man, the noble man, the man of prophecy, after so many ages of delay, was at length to be seen in his native valley. While the boy was still gazing up the valley one day and imagining that the great stone face returned his gaze, the noise of wheel was heard and a crowd of people cried, "Here comes the great Mr. Gathergold." So Mr. Gathergold was passing through that area. At this time, Ernest was deeply stirred by the idea of the great man. He was very much moved. Okay, he was very much influenced by it, and the fact that after such a long wait, this man is actually going to come. Okay, and he would get the chance to see this man. While the boy was still gazing up the valley one day and imagining that the great stone face returned his gaze. Now, this was something which Ernest did a while. Okay, for a long period of time he has been doing this. He has been having this silent communication with the great stone face. He would look upon the great stone face and he would see that the great stone face is smiling at him. So he would do this often. Okay. And at that time, this was something that was common with him. He would do it. He would pass quite a lot of time doing that. Then the noise of wheels was heard and a crowd of people cried, "Here comes the great Mr. Gathergold." So that man who had the resemblance had come at last. A carriage drawn by four horses dashed round the turn of the road. Within it, thrust partly out of the window, appeared the face of an old man with yellow skin. "The very image of the great stone face," shouted the people. "Sure enough, the old prophecy is true. Here we have the great man at last." And what greatly puzzled Ernest, they seemed actually to believe that here was the likeness which they spoke of. He turned away sadly from the wrinkled shrewdness of the unpleasant face and gazed up the valley where the stone face seemed to say, "He will come. Fear not, Ernest, the man will come." So, Mr. Gathergold had become kind of like a celebrity in that valley and everybody was talking about him. A carriage drawn, as he was very rich, he had a very good, a carriage which was drawn by four horses, it dashed round the turn of the road. Within it, thrust partly out of the window means he had put his face forward partly from the window to see outside, and his face could be seen plainly by the people who looked at him. So he was a man with yellow skin. Okay, so his complexion was kind of yellow. Then everybody was saying, "The very image of the great stone face. Sure enough, the old prophecy is true. Here we have the great man at last." So all the common people who were there except Ernest, whoever saw him, they believed that this great stone face was this man. Okay. But Ernest did not believe it. And what greatly puzzled Ernest, they seemed actually to believe that here was the likeness which they spoke of. And this was something which confused Ernest, that this people actually believed him to be a likeness of the great stone face. He turned away sadly from the wrinkled shrewdness of that unpleasant face and gazed up the valley. So, this man, Mr. Gathergold, didn't even have the kind look that the great stone face had. He did not have the pleasant expression which the great stone face had. So, there wasn't any chance that he looked like the great stone face. The appearance of the man might have been like that for the people to think of him, but Ernest thought that the most remarkable feature of the great stone face was this benign and smiling expression that it had. But this man had a shrewd expression, something which you can expect from a shrewd businessman. Okay, he was a rich and successful businessman and he was shrewd. Okay, he didn't have that pleasant or kind look in his face. Then when he looked at the great stone face, it seemed to tell him that don't be afraid or don't be sad, Ernest. He will come. The man will come. The years went on and Ernest grew to be a young man. He attracted little notice from the inhabitants of the valley. They saw nothing remarkable in his way of life, except that when the labor of the day was over, he still loved to gaze upon the great stone face. Their idea was that this was a folly but pardonable, because Ernest was industrious, means somebody who worked a lot. Industrious means a person who was a disciplined worker, kind and neighborly. So Ernest grew up to be a young man, and nobody talked much about Ernest. There wasn't anything remarkable about him which attracted the residents to talk about him, except there was just one part of his nature or habit which attracted other people, or which was a subject of gossip among them, and that is, after the day's work was done, Ernest would go and gaze upon the great stone face for a long time. And people thought that this was a folly, this was something odd, this was a mistake kind of thing. But because Ernest was such a nice boy, he was such an industrious man, that nobody took any offense from this habit of his. Okay. They did know that the great stone face had become a teacher to him, and that the sentiment which was expressed in it would enlarge the young man's heart. The sentiment, what is the sentiment? That is the emotion which was expressed by the great stone face, the emotion of kindness, the emotion of hope, okay. That would be reflected in the young man's heart as well. Everybody knew that Ernest took his teachings from the great stone face, and everyone else also understood that since his teacher was such a great embodiment of this great spirits, that he would also grow up to be a kind and gentle man and fill it with deeper sympathies than the others' hearts. That his sentiments, the sentiments which was expressed in the great stone face, would even grow in earnest, and he would feel more sympathetic towards his comrades, towards the people who lived with him, much more than any other young man. They did not know that from this would come a better wisdom than could be learned from books. Neither did Ernest know that the thoughts which came to him so naturally in the fields at the fireside were of a higher tone than those which all men shared with him. Okay, and Ernest also did not understand. Now they did know, that is the people who were experienced in his village, they knew that this kind of education which he was receiving from the stone face, it would give him a much better wisdom of handling life, and that wisdom cannot be learned from books. Ernest also did not know about it. Ernest did not know that the thoughts which came to him so naturally in the fields and at the fireside were of a higher tone than those which all men shared with him. Okay, now those thoughts which came to him naturally, those thoughts which came to him from inside, they were much different than the people who work with him. That means his ideals, his emotions were of a nobler nature than that which belonged to the other men of his same age, okay, or those who were his peers. Other men also worked in the fields, but they did not have this kind of lofty ideals, this kind of higher thoughts which Ernest had. A simple soul, as when his mother first told him the old story, he beheld the marvelous face looking down the valley and still wondered why its human likeness was so long in coming. Now, Ernest was a simple soul. He was a very simple minded man. He was not cynical. He didn't doubt the prophecy. He didn't question the truth of it. He was simple and honest young man. He believed in the story which his mother told him, and even to this day, he dreamt that one day that man would come and he would make sure that the prophecy comes true. Ernest still believed in that, and so he was a simple soul. Okay, his mind was not polluted like many others. So in this video, I'm not going to teach you anymore. I'm going to continue with this chapter in the next class. Thank you, students.